to America, JFK, news of a shooting.
Dallas, November 22nd, 1963. The President of the United States has been shot.
There were two more bangs close together, like bang, bang. I said, those are shots.
Three shots were fired at the motorcade.
One man has to tell America the news.
Order Cronkite in our newsroom.
He wants to be first, but he knows he has to be right.
Get it first, but get it right. The temptation had to have been great to say flat out, President Kennedy has died.
Walter wants us to wait.
This is the story of one man's mission to be first with the news on the biggest break of his career.
Look, this is the President of the United States. You gotta get it right.
It's a story full of extraordinary memories.
It was just inconceivable that one nutcake could do all this damage, blow a man's brains out. That man happened to be President of the United States.
And personal challenges.
I wanted to bawl and scream and yell and be mad and everything else, but I couldn't do my job for you. I owe you a calm account of what is happening.
You wanted to do something that was bigger than yourself. You want to be part of something that counts, that's important, matters. Well, a president has been assassinated. Halt this matters.
Of chaos and confusion.
No, Randall's not in New Orleans. He's in Dallas because we sent him there.
In Dallas and New York.
They had the story of a lifetime, and they didn't know what to do with it.
It's a story of two men of the same age, defined by a single moment in time, and the news no one wanted to hear.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time.
November 21st, 1963. President Kennedy is leaving for a three-day swing through Texas. He and Mrs. Kennedy will visit Austin, the state capital, San Antonio, Houston, Fort Worth, and Dallas. Dallas, the oil man city where Kennedy and his running mate, Lyndon Johnson, had narrowly been elected in 1960. The city where some of the most conservative organizations in the country were based, controlled by men and women who thought that in seeking to negotiate an end to the Cold War, the president was selling out to the Soviets.
Dallas was more of a class society than most of the rest of Texas, which is important to understand the context in which the Kennedy assassination happened. Dallas was a businessman's town, a commercial town, as opposed to Houston, which was a blue-collar working town. Dallas was the only place in Texas that looked east for approval. Dallas cared what New York and Boston and Washington thought.
It was pretty much known around the world as sort of being the hate capital of the world. And that mostly stemmed from an incident in 1960 when Lyndon Johnson, who was a native Texan and had been the senior senator for many years, was running as John Kennedy's vice presidential nominee and made a political stop in Dallas. And they staged a big demonstration against the Johnsons and against the Kennedy-Johnson ticket. And they accosted Johnson and his wife. One of them, as a matter of fact, grabbed Mrs. Johnson's gloves and threw them in the gutter. And of course, this made news around the world.
It had a reputation of being tough on Democratic candidates for national office that came. Adlai Stevenson, Democratic candidate for president, had been there. He and his party had been roughed up a bit. But the point is that this came together in Dallas in a way it didn't any place else in the state.
Being a native of Dallas, it was a Dallas that I hardly knew. But for the rest of the world, Dallas was really recognized as this center of hatred and intolerance. And I only really came to understand that after the events of November 22nd.
That night, things warm up. After a brief rest, President Kennedy and the First Lady venture from the White House to attend a round.
The storm of history was about to strike Dallas, America, and the world. At its center would be a young president who'd offered a vision of hope and whose life of promise was to be cut short. 2.5 days of celebration. The manner of his passing means the name John Fitzgerald Kennedy will never be forgotten, and nor will that of Walter. Walter Cronkite, who will be forever linked with that dreadful day in Dallas. By 1963, Walter Cronkite was not only a big name at CBS, he was also a big name in America. Exactly 8 weeks before the assassination of John Kennedy, Newsweek chose him for their cover story. He was 46, the same age as the president.
I leave for work every morning with a briefcase full of papers, but they might as well be sandwiches. Nothing you can carry in a briefcase is going to tell you how the day's news will break. You just have to ride with it and put it all together as it happens.
Cronkite had been a reporter for 30 years, first as a radio announcer in Kansas City, then as a distinguished wire service correspondent for United Press. His byline appeared in every newspaper in the United States. But it was television that made him.
I'm not sure that if Walter Cronkite walked into a television station today, he could get hired. They would say, well, he doesn't look like an anchor. He didn't. He looked like a regular guy.
Cronkite was the old school of journalism. He was the one to which almost every journalist I've ever known looked up to as being the model to which we should aspire.
He was like the people he was reporting for. He had been there. He was an old wire service guy. You know, Ed Murrah never liked him very much because he thought he wasn't really that much of an intellectual. Walter was an intellectual, but in a very different kind of way, because he had this curiosity that never stopped.
What scripts have we got in so far?
To Walter Cronkite would fall the task of telling America and the world that Kennedy had been assassinated. It was a moment in which he would have to summon the experience of a lifetime.
Cronkite reads copy against the stopwatch.
He was both a good reporter and a powerful television presence. You have to be hungry for the story, but not hungry for the glory. It was a remarkable combination of being ambitious in a healthy way to be the dominant television journalist of his time, for example. But he'd lived this long, rich, varied life, and it kept him from doing things that he knew he shouldn't do.
Kennedy and Cronkite were Second World War veterans. Kennedy had commanded a torpedo patrol boat in the Pacific and distinguished himself by saving his colleagues when the boat was sunk. Cronkite had been a war correspondent, first in London, then after D-Day in Europe, landing in a glider with Allied troops. So to use an expression which would later appear in Kennedy's inauguration address, they had both been tempered by war.
Cronkite said during the war that he woke up every morning trying to beat the hell out of the Associated Press and the International News Service, the other great wire service of the day. And he took that competitive spirit with him to CBS.
Walter Cronkite was really a newspaper man, and newspapermen don't always adapt to television. But Cronkite was a natural. Through the 1950s, he hosted the political conventions that selected presidential candidates and the elections themselves. The term anchorman was coined for him. He quickly came to understand what television was capable of and how it would change the face of American politics. And when, in 1962, he was offered the anchor chair of the CBS Evening News, he accepted, with one condition. He wanted to be the managing editor.
Nobody in television knew what a managing editor was, so there was no problem. You want to be managing editor, you're the managing editor. But Walter knew.
A managing editor, he felt, and they agreed, gave him the ultimate power of what stories would be on the air and how they would be handled.
He wanted the place to look as much as possible like a real working newsroom, and that's why he insisted on that horseshoe where he's the copy editor and we, the writers, are sitting around it and we're writing his stuff so that the audience doesn't get the impression of a television studio. They're in a newsroom. There's a sense of intimacy, and that had not been done before.
And camera lines that carry the pictures to the monitors.
By 1963, the war correspondent turned television reporter turned anchorman, was riding high. Millions of viewers tuned in every night to watch him. And the executives at CBS were persuaded that news needed more than 15 minutes every night. To launch the extended CBS Evening News, Walter Cronkite interviewed the president. It was September 1963. 8 weeks later, their lives would collide with history in the most dramatic way. But here on Cape Cod, they sat down to discuss Kennedy's policies, including the latest on Vietnam. Walter took his wife, Betsy. The president obligingly posed for photographs. And Walter and Betsy may have fallen for the charm of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, the 35th president of the United States. The oldest president to hold office, Dwight Eisenhower, had been succeeded by the youngest, and the newsmen were going to make the most of it.
He was so young and so dynamic and so different than his predecessors. Television was a new medium, and Kennedy had mastered that medium and mastered it in a way that helped Walter Cronkite and CBS and all the other networks really grab the imagination of the American people. I think he touched an emotional chord that had never really been touched before because of that genius on television.
All through September and October and the first week of November, the candidates carry their message to the people.
Before 1960, presidential campaigns had been fought, won or lost, in black and white, on the pages of people's newspapers. When Jack Kennedy seized the nomination of the Democratic Party in the summer of 1960 and the presidency in November, it was still in black and white, but it was on television. The Kennedys had money and they spent it on airtime. They knew they had to appeal to a new generation.
So John F. Kennedy, the 43-year-old senator from Massachusetts, becomes president-elect of the United States.
When JFK, as he came to be known, was elected, his inauguration speech electrified the nation, who watched it on television. It was January 20th, 1961.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans born in this century, tempered by war, disciplined by a hard and bitter peace, proud of our ancient heritage, and unwilling to witness or permit the slow undoing of those human rights to which this nation has always been committed and to which we are committed today at home and around the world.
More people watched that inaugural address on television than any other to date. And what they saw was a visual handing over from one generation to another. There was Dwight Eisenhower bundled up in his coat, and there's John F. Kennedy standing there without a hat and without an overcoat.
Let every nation know.
And there is Jackie in this wonderful outfit, completely different from the other women. It was a visual affirmation of what he said in the speech, which is a torch has been passed to a new generation. Well, people heard that and looked and saw that torch being passed.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country.
The fact that John Kennedy had briefly been a journalist, that he'd written a best-selling book, Profiles in Courage, and that his rhetoric was unmatched by any other speaker, struck a chord with the young reporters assigned to the White House and with the men who had mastered television, which was to become the defining medium of the Kennedy years.
He was one of us. He was of the same age as we were. You know, usually the president's a little older. He was a World War II veteran, which millions of people in this country were. He was well-educated, well-spoken. Once he got into the White House, we had these pictures of John and his sister Caroline running around the Oval Office. The whole package was wonderful.
He was an exceedingly good-looking guy, and his wife was very good-looking. The children were charming. they exploited that to the hilt. They sold the family, and they made access for photographers and film crews, and they realized they had an extraordinary political commodity just in the beauty of the family. I was finding what all the other reporters who'd covered him through the campaign had learned years ago, the extraordinary charisma and charm of this man, who seemed to move always in his own high pressure. He created weather around him, as some film stars and people do. The things they did in their spare time were extraordinarily attractive. I mean, sailing off Hyannis. They had fabulous raw material to work with, and they realized it.
Kennedy was smart, and he was bright, and he was handsome, and he was witty. He was very funny. He was suave. He was cool. And he was the new world. This was what was going to be. And he was promising great things. He said we could fly to the moon. And we all believed him.
There's a hidden workforce on London streets.
Yeah, we are earning bundles of money.
Collecting your trash.
What's that? Hello, hello?
And turning it into treasure.
It's made all this money.
Last year, I think we turned over about 7 million.
With unique access to the life of a London yard. Scrappers, Thursday at 9 on 4.
Me and you just singing on the train. Me and you listening to the rain. Me and you, we are the same. Me and you.
Carrying a mucus cough and cold around all day can be exhausting. Benylin cough and cold tablets relieve stubborn mucus cold symptoms, whilst thinning and loosening chest mucus. Help shift your mucus with Benylin. And for cough relief so you can get a good night's sleep, ask your pharmacist for Benylin Mucus Night.
This is for the players. For those that leap into battle in the blink of an eye. For the drivers that compete for their club, no matter where they are.
For those that triumph together. This is for the game changers. This is for the players. This is PS4.
From the creators of World of Tanks, take the battle to the skies. Pilot hundreds of legendary warplanes in 15-on-15 dogfights. World of Warplanes. Play for free at warplanes.eu.
Where are you going?
Out.
Even though your eyebrows terrify me, you did help me get that bee in March. Because you're the fittest girl in year 10. You looked after my nan.
Because you're always full of surprises. Love, Mum and Dad.
This Christmas, let's make the people that make us feel good, Boots.
I've got your kid. Yeah!
Trust me, I'm coming.
Jason Statham, James Franco, Winona Ryder, Kate Bosworth. Homefront, December 6th.
There was a time when Christmas presents were pretty boring. Now things are different and exciting. There's a twinkle in the air and everything's more interesting. Life is less ordinary. Dull has gone brilliant, and no one knows what predictable's going to do next. We can be special and surprising. No more presents you can sleep through. Now every sheep is a horse, every bottle is a penguin, and everyone has a present with their name on it. And where did all this come from? Not on thehighstreet.com. For a life less ordinary.
It's hard to resist the sound of solid wood. At Oak Furnitureland, you can have it in your home for Christmas. This stunning country cottage dresser is now an amazing $6.99. This beautifully crafted solid wood coffee table now just $1.99. Order now for guaranteed Christmas delivery. Oak Furnitureland.
New Shore with Motion Sense, activated by your movement. The more you move, the more it protects. Sure, it won't let you down.
Right now, there's half price on artificial trees and lights, like this 7-foot Montana tree for just $39.99. Homebase, get ready for a magical Christmas.
My name is Lee Oswald, and I've come to renounce my American citizenship.
When something like this is done, it can't be undone.
No one ever listens to me. I am valuable. Mr. Oswald, what do you say to those who will call you a murderer? In time, they will see me as a hero.
Don't you care about your own country?
Go home, Mr. Oswald.
Verdict?
Jerk. I don't say I was a security risk.
Killing Kennedy. Tomorrow at 9 on 4.
In that November week in 1963, President Kennedy went to Texas at the invitation of State Governor John Connally. He intended to deal with divisions among Southern Democrats, but he also had an eye to re-election. So the trip had an odd feeling, party business, but also all the hallmarks of a campaign, the open limo, the crowds, a few supporters with placards for 1964.
This was a political trip. 1 year away from the 1964 re-election campaign. He expected it to be a tough campaign. He thought he possibly could lose, given the fact that he won by such a narrow margin in 1960. And this trip was a political trip, top to bottom. Both Lyndon Johnson and Governor John Connally had said to the president, listen, the Republicans are going to raise a lot of money for the 1964 election, and you better get down here early and settle some of the money that we got the last time, get it for 1964.
If the Kennedys had any doubts about their popularity in Texas, they must have been reassured by the crowds in San Antonio and Houston, where they honored Albert Thomas, the congressman who had secured the Space Center for Houston. He was to play a part in the events of the following day. A few hours later, they flew on to Fort Worth, and the following morning, the day the president would go to Dallas. The crowds at a Chamber of Commerce breakfast in Fort Worth treated him like a rock star.
The president, the vice president, all of them were gathered at the Texas Hotel in Fort Worth that morning. 10,000 people had turned out the night before when Air Force One landed at Carswell Air Force Base. He got an overwhelming reception.
In the morning at Fort Worth, when Kennedy came out to talk and then walked around the perimeter shaking hands with everybody, and the crowd was delirious, absolutely delirious. And I was inside the Secret Service, just near them, beside him, right beside Kennedy a few times. I walked beside him with Jim Wright, the Speaker of the House at the time, and Kennedy had shaken all his hands, and he pulled a clean white handkerchief out of his pocket and wiped his hands on it, and it made the handkerchief very dirty. And he said, well, that was all right. And he was very cool about it, about this explosion of rapture in all these faces.
Air Force One made the short flight from Fort Worth to Dallas. At Love Field, the crowds were just as large. If this was the hate capital of the world, there was little evidence of it. It had been raining in Fort Worth, but in Dallas the sun was shining, and the decision was taken to remove the cover of the presidential limousine for the 10-mile motorcade through the city to the trademark.
The president, first lady, everybody connected with the Kennedy administration had to be breathing a great sigh of relief and smiling a bit and maybe punching each other in the ribs saying, you know what? We can carry Texas again in this next election. Look at these crowds. And based on the warmth and the size of the crowds, they had good reason to think that. The outpouring of goodwill in Dallas toward President Kennedy and toward Mrs. Kennedy, the First Lady, far exceeded what even Lyndon Johnson and John Connally, the Texas political powers, thought was possible. They were hopeful, but in Dallas, they didn't quite know what they were going to get. The crowds were large and warm, and I think it's fair to say that the reception in Dallas maybe even surprised Dallas.
We'd been expecting something to happen, but that seemed totally blown away by the rapture of the Dallas crowds once we got into the main part of town.
Until the turn was made in front of the school book depository, it had been a great day for the president and for the first lady and for their hopes of changing their image in Texas.
We had turned into Dealey Plaza, and there was a bang. And we all said, what was that? Was that a shot? And then there were two more bangs close together, like bang, bang. I said, those are shots. Stop the bus.
There was three shots, and we didn't know what happened, except that the presidential car ahead of us sped up immediately. And then one of the fellows in the bus knew a gunshot when he heard it. He said, those are gunshots.
The air was filled with the most incredible screaming. It was as though every choir in the country was gathered there and they were all singing out of tune, out of key, you know, off key. It was the most incredible sound.
When Lee Harvey Oswald shot John Kennedy from a window of the Texas Book Depository, one reporter, above all others, grabbed the story and knew what to do with it. Merriman Smith was a correspondent for United Press International. Smitty knew Walter Cronkite because they shared a common bond, the training of a wire service reporter.
Merriman Smith was the White House UPI reporter, and he was in a car about four back from the presidential limousine. He hadn't seen much, but he did hear three shots, and Smitty, unlike some of the other reporters, knew that these were not firecrackers, these were gunshots. He was a gun fancier. And so he picked up the phone, and it was the only phone available. There were no cell phones. There was one phone in the press pool car. He grabs the phone, and he starts dictating to his desk in Dallas.
The phone rang.
UPI?
I recognized the voice. The voice was that of Merriman Smith, who was our UPI White House correspondent.
Don't
the voice
talk.
On the other
right,
end
just stop
was
talking.
Screaming.
Just listen.
Three shots were fired at the motorcade.
Three shots were fired at the motorcade.
I said,
I
can't
hear
you. I would have thought that most people in the room had heard him, maybe even down in the street.
Three shots were fired at the motorcade.
Well, at this point, I had grabbed some paper and rolled it into a typewriter. And I started writing just what he said, Dallas UPI, three shots. And I suddenly realized I can't do this. I can't do it alone. And my
Jack,
boss,
it's Smitty.
Jack Fallon, grabbed the phone out of my hand. I was handing it to him. And he started talking to Smitty, and he was writing. And the first bulletin moved that time.
On the teletype machines, five bells meant a bulletin. It was five bells that attracted the attention of the CBS newsroom in New York. It was 12:34 in Dallas, 1:34 in New York.
UPI says three shots were fired at the president's motorcade this afternoon in downtown Dallas.
I'm Walter Walter.
The bulletin didn't say Kennedy had been hit, let alone wounded. It didn't say exactly where in Dallas the motorcade was. In fact, it didn't say very much. Going on air with the news that shots had been fired in Dallas would beg the question, what happened next? Which was a question Walter Cronkite and his team couldn't answer yet.
The wire service maxim was get it first, but get it right. And Merriman Smith is also struggling with the phone. The Associated Press reporter was in the back seat saying, it's my turn, it's my turn, give me the phone. He's beating on him, and Merriman Smith just continues to dictate. And he didn't know a lot more information, but he knew enough, being the veteran newsman that he was, to not report conjecture or something that he thought might have happened. He could only report what he had seen. Cronkite relied on the wires. He knew Merriman Smith, and he knew that anything that he reported would be accurate.
Make it a bulletin precinct. Where did that happen?
In New York, they waited 5 minutes. Cronkite wanted to be first to break the story, but what was the story? In those 5 minutes, ABC Radio News was first to report the shooting at 12:36, 2 minutes after the wire report. But still, CBS held off. 5 minutes in Dallas for the picture to become clearer.
The big question was, of course, whether the president had been hit.
Three shots.
Suddenly,
is he hurt?
I knew exactly who would know what was going on. And I dialed the Dallas police office.
Bill Hampton, UPI, give me dispatch.
It suddenly occurred to me that the one person who would know what was going on would be the police dispatcher.
Yes, what can you tell me about the shots fired at the president's motorcade?
He said, well, the president's been hit. I just got off the phone with a motorcycle escort. There's blood in the back of the car, and they're taking him to Parkland Hospital.
We proceeded to the trademark, where we were going to hear the president speak, and he wasn't there. So I called, we all called, but I happened to get through first, I believe. And we called our New York offices, and the New York office was saying, Merriman Smith is saying the president has been shot. He's in Parkland Hospital. So I screamed, Parkland Hospital, to all my colleagues. And we dumped everything, the phones and everything, and ran and scrambled. It was chaos.
Now, reporters knew that the president had been hit, and Merriman Smith, the UPI man on the spot, was able to see it with his own eyes. When he arrived at Parkland Hospital, there was no proper crime scene, and the president was still lying in the open limousine.
Merriman Smith had talked to Clint Hill, who was one of the Secret Service agents that day, and the press car arrived even before they took the president inside. And Clint Hill was there trying to get a gurney out to get the president inside to the emergency room. And Smitty asked him, how is he? And Clint Hill said, he's dead.
I'm heading out across Britain.
Join Tony Robinson on a hike through history.
To tread in the footsteps of historical giants.
Discovering clues to mysteries of the past that you can only find on foot. Walking Through History starts tomorrow at 8 on 4.
Now the calm is sunlit now upon the beach at Grunewald. Brilliant and naked, just the way that authors look. I'd rather be home.
From the creators of World of Tanks, take the battle to the skies. Pilot hundreds of legendary warplanes in 15-on-15 dogfights. World of Warplanes. Play for free at warplanes.eu.
When it's raining cats and dogs. When there are leaves on the line. When it's the wrong kind of snow. When there are four seasons in just one day. Quattro, the legendary all-wheel drive system from Audi. Available on 43 models.
It's hard to resist the sound of solid wood. This beautifully crafted solid wood coffee table now just $199. Order now for guaranteed Christmas delivery. Oak Furnitureland.
Like a rolling stone.
The very best of Bob Dylan.
Don is in a basement mixing up the medicine. I'm on a pavement.
The voice of a generation.
Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's
hero of our time.
Lay, 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 lay. Hey.
18 timeless classics. This is the very best of Bob Dylan. Out now.
With Betway, you can now bet in-play on a massive range of sports via your mobile, tablet, Mac and PC. And with a free bet of up to £50 to get you started, wherever you are, you've never been so close to the action. Betway.com.
May good fortune be with you, may your guiding light be strong. Build a stairway to heaven with a prince or a vagabond. And whatever road you choose,
so that and there's the new addition to the family.
I'm right behind you, win or lose, forever young.
Everybody downstairs to see the president.
President Kennedy shot in Dallas.
It is the president.
I know who it is.
Your son killed the most important person in the world.
It's my story, too.
We had the assassin of the president in our office.
We had him, and we could have stopped him!
Parkland, in cinemas now.
This was the hardest time of my entire life.
In March 2012, British pilot David Simpson was charged with the massacre of 13 people in the Central African Republic.
I am currently in prison. Are you telling me no, I didn't do it?
I hadn't seen any sign of any of the people for months. While we're there, we hear voices. It was shocking. It was so shocking.
He spends 162 days in prison.
It's lunchtime, and we're having our one meal a day.
Discover the truth behind this shocking story. Safari, Witchcraft and Murder, Tuesday at 9 on More 4.
All right, hold the line. You've got to find Rather for me.
10 bells this time on the teletype machine in the CBS newsroom. The signal for a flash. And what Walter Cronkite read was, Kennedy seriously wounded, perhaps seriously, perhaps fatally, by assassin's bullet.
Kennedy seriously wounded, perhaps seriously, perhaps fatally, by
assassin's For the first time,
bullet.
The word assassin right, had appeared.
He knew when those bells started ringing in the newsroom that this was an incredible story. I mean, for anything to be slugged a flash, it had to be monumental news.
Are we going to go to air?
We're getting it all
yes,
from...
We are.
At that,
that
point,
means this
Smith
needs to be confirmed right now.
And Walter, everybody hollers, we've got to get on the air.
Yes, we'll go to air. I want this confirmed.
Walter Rather's not in New Orleans. He's in Dallas because we sent him there.
Walter Cronkite knew CBS had to get on air and fast. But there was a problem.
There's no camera. Where's the camera? There's no camera. We can't go to air without a camera.
They were screaming, we've got to get on the air. Let's get on the air. And they couldn't do that because there was no camera, unbelievably, in the CBS newsroom.
The tech guys have it.
There was a frenzy. What do you do with this story? And of course, at CBS, as some of the other studios, they did not have the ability to break into television. They had the story of a lifetime, and they didn't know what to do with it.
They don't know where anybody is. they don't know what's happening.
Once you turn it on, it used to take 20 minutes to align that camera to where you could put it on television. 20 minutes of back and forth between the cameraman and the control room. This thing has vacuum tubes in it.
Ernie, how long?
It has dozens of buttons on the back, and they're working to get it lined up.
ABC Radio had already alerted the nation to the shooting in Dallas. Right now, across the city, in New York, ABC Television and NBC must be within seconds of breaking the story. Walter Cronkite desperately wanted to beat them, but the technology wouldn't allow it.
They were making contingent plans, and they decided, we've got to get on the air. What we can do is Walter Cronkite can go into the radio booth and do an audio bulletin.
Voice only.
And that's what they did.
Keep me updated with any information on the wire.
Of course.
It was real nice of the boy.
And I thought about it, and I gave it a great deal of thought, Grandpa.
Here is a bulletin from CBS News. In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting.
This was really a radio broadcast on television, but it didn't matter. CBS beat NBC by a minute. It was 12:40.
More details just arrived. These details about the same as previously. President Kennedy shot today just as his motorcade left downtown Dallas. Mrs. Kennedy jumped up and grabbed Mr. Kennedy. She called, oh no, the motorcade sped on. United Press says that the wounds for President Kennedy perhaps could be fatal.
Walter Cronkite had very little to go on. He was a master at embellishing. I mean, he knew details about the politics. He knew the reason for the trip to Dallas. He was able to put in the background that would add to the story without advancing it unnecessarily.
First thing that goes through your mind is disbelief. This cannot be happening. When something explodes, when a totally unexpected story breaks right in the middle of the routine, and you know what happens? Everybody falls into his pattern. These are people who know what they're doing. These are very, very good people. And all of a sudden, you can almost hear a click. The people who need to be on the phone are on the phone. The people in the control room are getting you on the air. Everybody knows what to do.
UPI, Secret Service member heard to say Kennedy is dead.
Eddie, what are we doing on this?
The Secret Service?
Yep.
Did we get a name on this?
The CBS television news team knew what to do. But one thing would come to dominate the next 60 minutes. The quest to be first and right.
From the moment that you worked your first day at the wire service, they emphasized how important it was to get things right. It was so much more difficult to take back a mistake that you might make.
A Secret Service man was heard to say he's dead as the president was lifted from the rear of the White House touring car, the famous bubble top from Washington, and taken into the hospital.
Get it first, but get it right.
The president and Governor Connally were taken into the emergency room, and witnesses there refused to comment on whether the president was still alive or not. As the bullet were heard to wing out
Look,
of the...
Look, this is the President of the United States. You got to get it right. You don't want to scare the whole country if indeed nothing has happened, and if indeed it's going to be a footnote to tonight's evening news. On the other hand, there's the awful possibility that something has happened. So what you got to do, you got to get on the air.
Secret Service men unlimbered their automatic...
175 million Americans had tuned into the three networks, the biggest television audience to date. 175 million Americans who were traumatized by the news and wanted more. 12:55. And then came a key moment which seemed to suggest that Walter Cronkite had been right to hold off announcing the president's death.
Albert Thomas now says Governor Connally and President Kennedy are both still alive.
Can we trust what Thomas says?
It's a representative from Houston. He's on the inside. He should know. Ellen, take this to Walter.
Stay with the service. I'm going to call her.
Get back on that last call.
Got it.
Yeah, right.
Representative Albert Thomas, the Democrat from Houston, Texas, says that he has been informed that President Kennedy and Governor Connally of Texas are still alive.
That was the thought that Cronkite took with him into the television newsroom when CBS was finally ready to go on air at 1 o'clock. Now every local CBS station in the country was taking the feed from New York.
Inside every small business owner, there's a top dog. He's the reason you like to be the boss. The Great Dane amongst Chihuahuas. He puts the dog in dogmatic. That's why a business loan from Everline has him super pumped. It's a way of borrowing that puts you in control. You can apply for as much as £50,000 for up to a year and even pay it back early with no extra fees. That dog is inspirational. Everline.com. Credit at your command.
Love the shoes. I believe this is yours.
We've all watched the catastrophic scenes on the news caused by the typhoon in the Philippines. More than 4 million children's lives have been devastated by the strongest storm ever to hit land. Homes and schools have been destroyed. Some children have lost their parents. Others don't even have food or clean water. Without urgent supplies, these children will struggle to survive. Yet just £5 could help provide a family with clean water. Please text SURVIVE to 78866. UNICEF is on the ground working to reach children with emergency life-saving food, clean water and essential medicines. But we can't do this without you. Every day our staff see how these supplies can make the difference between life and death. Text SURVIVE to 78866 so that we can be there for the children who have lost everything. Thank you.
Introducing the creator of Mary
Poppins. Never ever just Mary.
Our motion picture is going to make your Mary Poppins fly off the pages of your book.
Mr. Disney, Mary Poppins is not for sale.
Damn.
You don't know what she means to me.
Mary Poppins was a real person? I won't disappoint you.
She and the Banksy, they're family to me.
Trust me, Mrs. Travers. Don't you want to finish the story?
Saving Mr. Banks in cinemas November 29th.
I love it when someone, anyone, makes my life easy.
Like Benson's for beds.
I just wanted something that matched. So we bought the bed and the matching furniture all in one place, all at the same time. Easy. Which meant that I could create my own perfect little sanctuary just for me.
Mom, what's the tea?
Sometimes.
There's up to 20% off selected bedroom furniture and interest-free credit on everything over £150 at Benson's for beds. Offer ends Tuesday.
Yota Motulenghi's culinary adventure of the sun-kissed Mediterranean islands continues.
I can pick a lemon, literally, with my hand.
in search of the finest, freshest, rarest local ingredients.
Wow, it's beautiful.
And taking inspiration from traditional cooking.
It's quite amazing.
Bravo.
Bravo.
The results are mouth-watering.
This is from your lamb.
Bellissimo.
It tastes delicious.
The award-winning series continues. Ottolenghi's Mediterranean Island Feast. Thursday at 9, exclusively on More 4.
The television anchorman was broadcasting to the nation.
This is Walter Cronkite in our newsroom. There has been an attempt, as perhaps you know now, on the life of President Kennedy. He was wounded in an automobile driving from Dallas Airport into downtown Dallas, along with Governor Connally of Texas. They've been taken to Parkland Hospital there, where their condition is as yet unknown.
He is in the beating heart of the CBS newsroom in New York. We can all thank heavens that he was at work that day. He was calm, he was measured, and he was writing the first draft. He was a wire writer, and he was writing for us verbally. He was writing the lead.
A word just in from Congressman Jim Wright of Fort Worth says that he understands that both President Kennedy and Governor Connally, while seriously wounded, are still alive.
Now you have all of these professional people swinging into action. Everybody is going to be all over this story because it's the biggest story of the 20th century.
5 minutes after one, the confusion deepened. And now there was a new and sinister thought. Was this the action of a lone madman, or could the United States itself be under attack?
They closed the border with Mexico.
That's right, I got a call just before Fort Myers raised the alert.
B-52s on.
Is this nuclear?
We didn't know. This was where we were still in the Cold War. We didn't know. It was just inconceivable that one nutcake could do all this damage, blow a man's brains out. The man happened to be president of the United States.
Here's the thing, we were terrified. We didn't know what had happened. They had closed off the borders with Mexico, the large strategic air command base, the nuclear bombers, the B-52s, they were all based in Fort Worth. We didn't know if these were the shots fired in World War III. We didn't know what had happened.
The United States was not under attack. The shooting of President Kennedy had been the action of one man, but no one knew at the time. And it reinforced Walter Cronkite's instinct to be cautious.
Eddie, Walter wants a word.
Cronkite was the voice and then the face of the news that day, but he was the first to admit that it was a team effort. The reporters in the newsroom, the technicians, and the reporters in Dallas, CBS White House correspondent Robert Pierpoint, Eddie Barker, and Dan Rather. Cronkite would come to rely on these men as the story developed. Eddie Barker was news director of the local CBS station, KRLD, and had good local contacts. He chose to cover the lunch at the Dallas Trade Mart, where the president was due to speak. That was the location of the fixed camera, and that was where he had to stay to feed bulletins to New York.
And who was to have given the invocation here?
But Barker had a good contact at Parkland Hospital.
As you can imagine, there are many stories that are coming in now as to the actual condition of the president. One is that he is dead.
Eddie Barker, who was with the CBS affiliate in Dallas, was reporting that a doctor who was at the luncheon had called the hospital and been told that President Kennedy had been shot. Now, Walter Cronkite reported that as an unconfirmed report from Eddie Barker.
Let us recall for you now what has transpired in this.
KRLD is reporting they've been told by somebody in the hospital the president's dead. Only a rumor, but they've been told that. KRLD is saying.
Well, that's a repeat of something that you heard reported to you directly a moment ago from KRLD television in Dallas, and that is the rumor that has reached them at the hotel that the president is dead. Totally unconfirmed, apparently, as yet. However, let's go back to KRLD.
Dan Rather was near the motorcade when Oswald's shots rang out. He ran back to the newsroom at KRLD and called Parkland Hospital. 11 minutes past one.
I got through to Parkland Hospital. Switchboard operator Harrod said, I can't really deal with this. And I said, well, is there a doctor around? She said, well, all the doctors are busy. Eventually, the doctor came on the phone, and the doctor said, just matter-of-factly, that he believed that the president was dead. So I naturally want to get his name. And he said, well, I'm not authorized to talk, was it? And click went off. So I've lost the line at the hospital. But I redialed the hospital almost immediately, and the second call went through. That's when the switchboard operator, who was very helpful to me, said, listen, you know, there are two Catholic priests here. Maybe they can help you. When the priest got on the line, and I said, and he just said, matter of fact, he was obviously torn up about it, shaken about it, said he was dead. And I asked him to repeat it, and he did repeat it. And so now we have a doctor and a priest at the hospital, and we have Eddie Barker's hospital official at the trademark.
When Father Huber came to administer the last rites, we went out and talked to him and said over again, was he still alive when you administered the last rites? And he was kind of slightly rather evasive about it. He wouldn't actually say yes.
Two priests came out, and Hugh Seide and I ran over to the two priests and said, did you give him the last rites? And the priests nodded yes.
Parkland Memorial Hospital was besieged by reporters and camera crews. Many had managed to get inside before the FBI established a cordon around the building. Some reporters thought they knew more than others, but they all had one thing in common, a lack of telephones.
There was an old saying in UPI and journalism in general that you could have the biggest scoop in the world, but if you didn't have a way to get it out, it was the biggest secret in the world. But in those days, a calling party had to hang up to break a connection.
Don, it's Bill. I got a plan. I'm going to hang up. You're going to call back. We're going to have the line. Yeah, I'm going to hang up. Call back at 590.
I could hang up my phone, and as long as Don did not hang up the phone in the UPI office, that phone was ours. It was for the rest of the day. And so I did, and he called me right back, and I answered, and I said, okay. And he said, now go find Marilyn Smith.
Is it you? Great. It's chaos here. Don't hang up. Great.
I went in straight into the emergency room through the swing doors. There was Merriman Smith dictating a story because he'd been in the pool car. And there were nurses pulling on, saying, you can't use this phone, you can't. And he just went on dictating. One of the great things about being a wire service reporter, I'd worked for Reuters for 5 years, you learn how to dictate.
I grabbed a phone off a nurse's desk, which was the first one I saw, and I got into a fight with her. She said, no, you can't have that. Somebody might call. And I said, I need this. I remember we were screaming at each other.
People for the first time saw news as it's gathered and saw the process. Up until that time, all most people knew about the news was the final product. They read the story in the paper. They saw the story that had been edited and put on television. But they had no idea of the process of how it's gathered. And they suddenly discovered, hey, this is kind of a mess. People push and shove, and they shout, and they holler. And nobody seems to know what was going on. And I think in many ways, that sort of hurt the credibility of journalism.
In the midst of the confusion, Dan Rather and Eddie Barker spoke on the phone. They wanted to compare notes, to take stock. It was 19 minutes after one. What happened next was a game changer.
Eddie and I were on the phone. I knew he was at the trademark. I had an open phone line to New York, but I didn't realize how many people were on that phone line. It turned out at least three people from radio were on. And in New York, the radio operation and the television operation are close to each other, but are separated. So on the phone line, when I thought I was talking to Eddie Barker, somebody in New York said, you say the president was dead. I said, yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, the president of the United States is dead. John F. Kennedy has died of the wounds he received in the assassination in Dallas less than an hour ago.
It all happened very quickly, and the next thing I knew, they were playing the Star Spangled Banner.
We repeat, it has just been announced that President Kennedy is dead.
There wasn't any doubt in my mind that he was dead, but if somebody had said to me, well, Dan, do you think we ought to play the Star Spangled Banner and announce it? I would have said, that decision is above my pay grade.
Hello.
How do you take your tea, black or white?
Game's up, old boy.
Everybody needs someone to talk to.
Who are you?
It was you all along.
Our yearly celebration of exceptional cinema from around the UK.
Sit down, shut up, and watch.
The British Connection continues every night on Film 4.
Luke, what you made?
A cake.
And who's it for?
Santa.
Has he got anything for the reindeers?
Carrots and some water.
Why has he got six?
Because there's six reindeers.
I thought there was eight reindeers. One of them is missing.
What time is he going to be here?
We don't know. Nobody
knows.
Soon.
I fell asleep and it's Christmas Day. I fell asleep and it's Christmas Day.
It's Christmas.
If I could only whistle, so all I want for Christmas is my two front teeth. Two front teeth, my two front teeth.
Don't cook, just eat.
Don't eat, just cook.
Don't cook, just eat.
Don't eat, just cook.
Don't cook, just eat.
Don't eat, just cook.
Don't cook, just eat.
It's a sharp, mean, lean action thriller.
I've got your kid.
Dad! Trust me, I'm coming.
Statham, Franco, Homefront, December 6th.
National Lottery scratch cards have even more prizes, with 539,759 winners every single day.
At Currys PC World, Christmas savers like this HP touchscreen laptop. Compact and stylish with a 500GB hard drive, it's just $299. Save $170 on this exclusive LG 24-inch smart TV. It's only $179 with built-in Wi-Fi access and catch-up TV for BBC iPlayer, Now TV and Netflix. Make entertaining easier this Christmas. This upright freezer and this chest freezer are just £99 each. £50 off. In-store, ready to take home today. With great savings on all our health fryers like this Tefal Active Fryer, just £89, our lowest ever price. Get ready for Christmas with Currys PC World. We can help.
Yes, I'm a dog, so no, I can't sing. But there is always a song in my heart.
O2 4G. Music, sports, gaming, all the things that make your heart sing. In glorious 4G. Be more dog. O2.
We've got energy-saving glass.
Our heating bills have gone right down.
It's made such a difference.
And we got a great deal.
Get your free windows and doors quote from SafeStyle.
Easy steps to a beautiful tree.
Christmas tree.
God, it's only about another half a mile.
Oh, that's good, actually.
It's a bit bushy.
I don't think it's as good as last year's. Last year's was a bit of a find.
Blazing, you'll be for us. Strike the harp and join the chorus.
It's hard to resist the sound of solid wood. This beautifully crafted solid wood coffee table, now just £1.99. Order now for guaranteed Christmas delivery. Oak Furniture Land.
This was the hardest time of my entire life.
In March 2012, British pilot David Simpson was charged with the massacre of 13 people in the Central African Republic.
I am currently in prison. Are you telling me no, I didn't do it?
I hadn't seen any sign of any of the people for months. While we're there, we hear voices. It was shocking. It was so shocking.
He spends 162 days in prison.
It's lunchtime, and we're having our one meal a day.
Discover the truth behind this shocking story. Safari, Witchcraft and Murder, Tuesday at 9 on More 4.
Got one? Hold on.
1:22. CBS Radio had formally announced the death of the president based on information obtained by two reporters in Dallas.
Hold on.
Radio has announced he's dead.
Who says? They must be going with Dan's report out of Dallas.
But it was not enough for Walter Cronkite.
The temptation had to have been great to say flat out, President Kennedy has died. But they didn't do that because it was such a momentous thing to declare to the nation that they wanted to wait until it had been officially confirmed.
I understand.
Pierpoint's on the line from Parkland. Wants to speak to Walter.
You got
go ahead.
It sounds like Pierpoint's on the line.
I remember Pierpoint talking to Cronkite on the phone, and I was talking to Chet Huntley of NBC and Frank McGee of NBC, and I remember Pierpoint saying, Walter, you can't say the President of the United States is dead until it's official. Walter was very deliberative because he had time to think, and it was in his own instinct, I think, that you don't say he's dead until he's sure. On the other hand, you want to be first.
Pints of blood have been rushed into the room for transfusion purposes, and two priests were called to the room.
Most of the other reporters who were on the scene did indeed think he was dead, but nobody had officially said it.
There is the report in Dallas you heard from our affiliate there, Eddie Barker, that the president is dead, but that has not been confirmed by any other source.
Walter Cronkite, because of his background, because of his wire service training, because of his responsibilities as an anchor on a national network, knew that he didn't want to report what somebody was thinking or what somebody had been told by a second source. He wanted to wait until there was official confirmation from the White House.
Nowadays, you hear it, you stick it on the air. You hear it, you put it on the web. Whether it's true or not, nobody seems to care. In those days, everything was edited. Nothing went directly on the air without going through at least one other mind that's going to say, wait a minute, what do we really know here?
Everybody was trying to get this story and to get it right, and they were kind of working independent from one another. But the difference was Walter Cronkite was the guy who was making the call on television, and it didn't satisfy his set of standards, and that's why they didn't go with it.
For a full 5 minutes, the television newsroom agonized over whether to say the president was dead.
Walter says it's not strong enough. We can't just go on Dan Rather's confirmation.
I say we call the White House.
Eddie, are they going to announce this in Washington or Dallas?
Dallas, I think.
Pierpoint says that Kilduff is probably going to call a press conference.
Well, where's Salinger?
He's on his way to Tokyo, somewhere over the Pacific.
Well, Walter wants us to wait.
But it's crazy. We ran it on radio already. Why wouldn't we run it on TV?
What if Walter credits Dan with the information, then it's the best of both worlds, right? It's official and it's not.
Yeah,
I think that makes sense.
We just have a report from our correspondent Dan Rather in Dallas that he has confirmed that President Kennedy is dead. There is still no official confirmation of this, however. It's a report from our correspondent Dan Rather in Dallas, Texas.
So Cronkite announced that Dan Rather had announced the death of the president. But it wasn't the same as an official White House statement. At Parkland Hospital, the Secret Service wanted to get the new president, Lyndon Johnson, to the safety of Air Force One at Love Field. And President Kennedy's people were preparing to confirm the one fact no one wanted to hear.
When Johnson and party swept out, Pearpoint and I were there, but Matt Kilduff, who is the deputy press secretary, said, hey, you guys, come on, there's going to be a press conference. We couldn't go through the hospital complex. We had to go outside the whole perimeter. All the time, Pearpoint and I saying to him, he's CBS, I NBC, for God's sake, Mac, tell us, is he dead? Is he dead, Mac? Come on, are you going to tell us? Are you going to tell us he's dead? All the way until we got to the front of the hospital, went in, and there was a schoolroom there where I think they taught nurses. Kilduff took his place behind a desk, like the teacher's desk. He was crying, and he put his hands on the desk like this with his fingers spread, trying to steady himself. And then he said, President John F. Kennedy died today. And somebody said, just a moment, what time is it? And he said, everybody, it's 1 o'clock. And then they agreed, okay, it'll be 1 o'clock.
I took off running as fast as I could. 50 years on, and I can almost remember that little sprint I made. And there's a woman in a nurse's station who saw me running and sort of put her hand to her mouth. And there was a guy on a gurney who sort of sat up and looked at me. And anyway, I went and grabbed the phone.
Don, my God, he's dead. He's dead. He's really dead.
And Don Smith said, who, Bill?
The White House man, Malcolm Kilduff.
And I heard Don shout down to Jack, it's official, White House. And I could even hear Fallon shout across the newsroom. And I ended the phone, flash, President Kennedy dead.
Eddie Bliss got the copy and handed it to Walter. Everybody in the world has seen what happened then with Walter looking at the copy, and you can see him deciding, and he decides it is now time to tell the people the president is dead.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago. Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded.
Walter handled himself very, very professionally, very well, wiping his eyes a little bit and taking his glasses off. But who wouldn't have done that, to be moved by that news?
Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.
He was able to maintain that composure. It was something that he learned during the war.
President Kennedy at Dallas Airport this morning was cheerful and waving. It had been quite a triumphal tour of Texas.
The murder of a president is a horrendous thing, but Cronkite had seen worse during the war.
World War II made young men look much older. And when those young men came home to be anchors on television, they all looked like our dads, and in some cases, our granddads. And on that day, he was our dad.
With the benefit of all these years and the fact that I later got to know him, I think it was like, okay, I felt just like you did. I wanted to bawl and scream and yell and be mad and everything else, but I couldn't do my job for you. I owe you a calm account of what has happened.
He was the rock. The man that knew what was going on, and you could count on him to tell the story.
Let me recount for you this day's tragic developments so far. President Kennedy has been assassinated.
This is the combination of skills that you have accumulated throughout your lifetime to pour it all into that one little lens.
From Dallas, Texas, the flag.
Of all the images of that weekend, and there were many, Walter Cronkite almost letting his emotions get the better of him is perhaps the one that has stayed in most people's minds. There were stronger images to come, but that instant, when this all-American anchorman was so visibly touched by the awfulness of that official announcement, that was when television came of age.
NBC was just as much on the story, but now the world thinks that Cronkite announced Kennedy's death.
Here we are 50 years later, and the memories are all of Walter Cronkite and the coverage of almost nothing else.
Across the country, around the world. Everyone remembers what they were doing when they heard that President Kennedy was dead. But those covering the story in Dallas and New York could not allow themselves to let go.
This is devastating. The destruction is devastating. And we are Americans, like everybody in our audience, and we're all feeling it. And we have to just put that aside. You cannot weep. You cannot grieve. You have to think about 5 minutes from now on television. Later on, you'll weep, and later on, you'll grieve, but not now.
I remember being shaken, and I mean literally shaken, right down to the soles of my feet, when I realized that the president was dead. But in that moment, one of two things happens. Either your emotions consume you, and you begin to weep, perhaps literally, or professionalism takes hold, and you say, in essence, I can't do that. I can't let that happen now. The story is what counts.
To this nation's place in history, for the fact that we do stand on the edge of a great new era.
Your prayer as a reporter is, God, give me the big story. And being greedy reporters, most of us have a second prayer. And by the way, God, if you do give me the big story, could you please let me be at or near my best? This is why you got into journalism. You wanted to do something that was bigger than yourself. You want to be part of something that counts. That's important, that matters. Well, a president has been assassinated. Halsh, this matters.
Five o'clock that afternoon, I was told to go to the Dallas police headquarters that they had, this is the first time I heard that they had captured a suspect. It was sort of the first time I thought, oh yes, of course, somebody had to have done this.
There's an ominous symbol in Lee Harvey Oswald's murder weapon.
And I started jogging across the lawn at Parkland, and at that time there was a great huge live oak tree sort of in the middle of the lawn. I reached it and it suddenly hit me. My God, the President Kennedy is dead. And I stopped and I put my hand against the tree and I just started to cry. And I didn't know he had represented so much, especially to us who were just coming into adulthood at that time. And I sat there for maybe half a minute. And then I realized I had to get to the police station. And so I jogged on and got in the car and drove down to the Dallas police station. It was hard to take in. It's even hard to take in now.
They ask reporters, how is it you're able to do your job in the midst of tragedy? Well, the way you do it is you just focus on what's before you, as a doctor would. You get your job done, and then you, if there's an emotion, you feel that later. I realized I had no emotion after that, and it took a long time for it to come back. I never felt that way again until 9/11.
But a new world of law, where the strong are just and the weak secure.
He was a model.
And the peace preserved.
He was a model to which we hope the new world would aspire and follow and be like. And just like that, he's gone.
With my facial hair, everything needs to be just right. Growing these out anymore makes me look like my dad in the 70s. Man.
Trim, shave, edge with a Gillette Fusion ProGlide Styler.
Every bit of hair means something.
shave, edge, and trim your own style of mow this Movember with the ProGlide Styler.
Cheers, Merry Christmas!
It was the first Christmas we'd had round our house. I had to borrow extra plates from next door. Wish we'd borrowed the oven too. Learned our lesson though, didn't we? Never made that mistake again.
I see a lot of teeth that look great until I look at the gum line. The problem is, if you have plaque along the gum line, it can lead to gum problems. So I recommend Oral-B Pro Expert Premium Gum Protection Toothpaste. It's clinically proven to reduce plaque at the gum line in just 4 weeks. New Oral-B Pro Expert Premium Gum Protection Toothpaste.
I told Mum, Jack's mum makes the bestest cupcakes. So Mum grabbed the floral buttery and we made some too. They looked so yummy and fluffy. And Mum said, beat that, Mrs. Snooty Pants. Mum, it's Mrs. Snooty Pants.
Family life doesn't always go right, but baking cakes with floral buttery means you can't go wrong.
Come and see this, a new liquid gel.
Oh, it has a nozzle that stops by itself so nothing's wasted.
Smaller than before, but with more power in every drop.
So what?
It's as if it actually gets into the dirt and lifts it off.
How come it cleans so well but with so little?
It's because we're all so watery.
Yeah. New Flash liquid gel. There'll be jealousy all over the neighbourhood.
I remember the first time I went for a meal with my best friend Lizzie. We were at this little Italian place on the high street. She ordered pasta and I had something called pollo milanese. After we'd finished eating, Lizzie said, "It's on me." When I asked why, she said, "It's a little thank you for being a good friend of mine." Well, it felt brilliant. And that's exactly how I felt when I heard Lloyd's Bank were paying me back for some jeans I'd bought on my card. When I asked why, they said, "It's on us, as a little thank you." Apparently, they offer thousands of people the chance to get this every month. On everything from a couple of skinny lattes to a couple of tickets to the opera. And that's on top of the cashback I can get when I buy some of my everyday stuff. They're just small acts of kindness anyone can appreciate. And you know what? I'm sure that's something Lizzie's gonna love.
I'm the new butter.
Forrest Whitaker, Oprah Winfrey, John Cusack, Jane Fonda, Vanessa Redgrave, Alan Rickman, Robin Williams, the U.S. number one hit, The Butler.
When a plague of undesirables incretinates the people, I, the Quam Bedlam, will rise to mock them. Lamau.
It's not even physically possible, is it? OMG.
I've got grade 6 clarinet. I'm better than this.
The ultimate country and western instrument, the Bible.
Hey!
I, Bill Bailey, Quam Bedlam, on DVD now.
Me Back to Life, the sensational new album, out now.
We live in a wasteful society.
There's a hidden workforce on London streets.
Yeah, we are earning bundles of money.
Last year, I think we turned over about 7 million or something.
Collecting your trash.
It's metal, it's money.
What's that? Hello, hello?
And turning it into treasure.
If you're willing to put the hours in, it's like anything, isn't it? Pay off.
Good three figures. Not bad for a day.
I can't really know what a recession is. I could go out there and probably earn about 2 grand.
With unique access to the life of a London yard. Scrappers, part of Getting Rich in the Recession. Thursday at 9 on 4.
President Kennedy is dead of an assassin's bullet.
Walter Cronkite stayed on air that fateful afternoon, consolidating his initial lead over the other networks, trying to find out more about Lee Harvey Oswald, the assassin, and whether he was a part of a wider conspiracy, trying to make sense of it all.
What do we know about
but there's no sense to be made.
How much? Someone says he works in a book depository. Where's Johnson now?
We think he's coming back in Air Force One with the body. And Jackie, I guess.
All right. Keep on it. Yes, Oswald.
Yeah. 50 years on.
Yeah, I'm here.
The assassination of John Kennedy still has the capacity to move those who remember. For reporters, it may be because they saw him as one of them, the first president to properly engage with the press, the television president. For ordinary Americans who supported him, it may have been because the hope he offered in a dangerous world was snuffed out with him. For everyone else, the man who might have ended the Cold War was gone.
Khrushchev, the leader of Russia at that time, believed that with Kennedy's assassination, a great promising moment in U.S.-Soviet relations had ended, and it would be very difficult to recapture that. They also had a feeling they really didn't know Lyndon Johnson, but they knew Jack Kennedy. And when Lyndon Johnson came in, the first words out of his mouth were, "Let us continue." And what he meant by that was, "Let us, please, dear God, continue what it is that Kennedy represented in the U.S.
Charles de Gaulle said, "They're crying all over France. It's as if he was a Frenchman, a member of their own family." And this close personal connection that was felt, not just by Americans, by Europeans, explains the extraordinary number of memorials, the bridges, the streets, the schools, everything else that has been named for Kennedy. I like to say that if you could turn off all the lights in the world, except the lights that illuminated something named for John F. Kennedy, the schools and the bridges that astronauts sent into space from the Kennedy Space Center, would see a network of twinkling lights all over the United States and all over Europe, and also some in Africa and Asia.
The leaders of the world came to Washington to pay their respects. The funeral was set for Monday, 3 days after the assassination. For Walter Cronkite and his team, there was no time to think. The story rolled on.
I became a producer, and I'm starting to produce the death of the President of the United States. It's shocking. And it's all you have. It's all you have. And so you throw yourself into it.
We have suffered a loss that cannot be weighed.
This television marathon started. We will not be off the air for 4 days and three nights.
The slain president would lie in state, first at the White House, then at the Capitol. A million Americans would come to say goodbye. This story was moving so fast, newspapers couldn't keep up.
Through that weekend, American culture changed dramatically. Television easily replaced print as the main source by which Americans receive their news. There are Americans who didn't turn off their television set for 3 days. They walked with Mrs. Kennedy. The entire nation was able to mourn with the family. And thanks to television, we were all able to take part in it.
Walter Cronkite was the master of the moment. No one did it as well as he. This was a moment when television was the fireplace around which the American people gathered. Walter was the face of television. Maybe there were other people who could have done it as well, but I don't know anyone. I think people rallied around the television set to listen to Walter tell them how they should feel.
Walter Cronkite held the nation together and seamlessly melded the strands of the assassination, the lion in state, the procession to the Capitol, the funeral, and the burial at Arlington.
Only history can write the importance of this day. Were these dark days the harbingers of even blacker ones to come? Or like the black before the dawn, shall they lead to some still as yet undiscernible sunrise of understanding among men?
It was just everything altogether. It was a dignified, modest man who reflected back the best of us. We were watching this flat glass surface, the television, but we were really watching a mirror. He was Walter, he was us. That young president was everything we dreamed we could be.
There was a moment of incredible grief and lost promise for the country. The Israeli ambassador to the UN, Abba Ibn, said that in referring to President Kennedy's assassination, the tragedy is the difference between what is and what might have been. Every sentence Walter Cronkite uttered made that point without saying it.
That violent words, no matter what their origin or motivation, can lead only to violent deeds.
This is the larger question. Walter turned in his best day, and one of the best days the business of news has ever had, and he happened to do it on what was the worst day in modern times.
In those darkest moments, Walter Cronkite was father, son, uncle. And over all of this was the shadow of Dallas, where some reporters were still asking why.
I'd gone with a camera crew to shoot the display of flowers and notes that had been left at the site of the assassination. An elderly man came along, and there was a sort of stone wall, and he came and sat on the stone wall, and he put a transistor radio beside him. And at that moment, the Black Watch Regiment was passing the microphone in the funeral, and the pipes were playing a lament. Now, I had seen them on the White House South Lawn a few days before, with President and Mrs. Kennedy sitting on the balcony in the South Portico with their children, Carolyn and John John. My children were exactly their sex and ages. Hearing the bagpipes, I suddenly found I was crying. There were tears pouring down my face. It was the bagpipes and the memory of having seen them wheel and parade up and down with the pipes skirling and the drums rattling in that gorgeous autumn day just a few days before, and the bringing the children into it. And I had just moved my family back to the States. I said to myself, is this the country I've come back to and moved to? How could this have happened?
For many, including reporters hardened by the experience of war, this was the saddest weekend of their lives. For those who thought Jack Kennedy was the future, it was the end of a dream.
Tonight there will be few Americans who will go to bed without carrying with them a sense that somehow they have failed. If in the search of our conscience we find a new dedication to the American concepts that brook no political, sectional, religious, or racial divisions, then maybe it may yet be possible to say that John Fitzgerald Kennedy did not die in vain. That's the way it is. Monday, November 25th, 1963.
The hammer to the heart that was the assassination, it gave more poignancy and meaning to the moment of the Kennedy years for those of us who lived through it. And therefore, it was, it is, and it shall remain a moment for the ages. The Kennedy era will always be just one brief, glittering, shining moment in the broad sweep of American history. But what a moment.
For Walter Cronkite, it was the defining moment in a career that would continue for another 45 years. for him and for those who helped report it. There would never be another story like this.
Walter Cronkite was already becoming one of the most trusted broadcasters. But after that weekend, Walter became the most trusted person in America. It just reinforced my view that someday I hope I can work for Walter Cronkite. I wanted to be Walter Cronkite. I still do.
6 months after the assassination of President Kennedy, CBS made a documentary about a day in the life of Walter Cronkite. Nothing had changed. The newsroom on West 57th Street was the same. The teletypes chattered. The reporters were still there. The Cronkite team still gathered around his desk.
Clear that shot. Get Sokolow out. Get him out. Get him out.
Like their colleagues in newsrooms around the country, they felt that nothing would be quite the same again.
Adlai Stevenson tells the UN what we're doing in Southeast Asia. Pierre Salinger challenges the president's Latin American policy. President Johnson drops back another Alabama town.
Walter Cronkite, good night.
Tomorrow night over on Channel 4, factual drama based on a bestseller. Rob Lowe stars as the president in Killing Kennedy at 9. And More 4's commemoration of 50 years since the assassination of JFK continues with eyewitness accounts and the story of the president's darkest hour. Kennedy's nuclear nightmare is next.